Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this Future of Market Structure breakout session. So my name is Ezra Nahum. I'm responsible for engineering and operations for global markets.
My name is Liz Martin. I run our electronic trading business and equities globally and our European market making business.
Amy Hong, I'm responsible for market structure strategy for global markets.
So listen, we've come a long way since I started my career in financial services about 20 years ago. So we used to communicate by sending each other emails from our desktop and leaving each other voicemails. We moved on to Blackberries, and now we're using our wearable devices. We also used to save files and data to floppy disks and moved on to CDs, USB keys, and now all of that information is on the cloud. The market structure developments bring the markets to adapt to the new paradigm and inspire innovation. That innovation in turn evolves the market structure. What we're going to do in this session is really mostly follow up on the global markets presentation you've seen this morning, focusing on what we believe are the major catalysts that are driving the market structure evolution. And in doing so, we'll try to highlight really two things. One, how we continue to invest to best serve our clients, and two, how we prepare for the market structure of tomorrow in order to remain the market-leading liquidity provider that we are today. We're going to leave some time for Q&A at the end. You can submit your questions to events@gs.com, as you can see up here, or through the Investor Day app throughout the entire session. So, what are those catalysts? So we've identified three major catalysts that are driving the global market structure evolution. First of all, the increased regulatory environment. Second, the technological developments. And third, the changing investing landscape. So let's start with the regulatory environment. The markets are more global than ever before. They're also more regulated than ever before. This has resulted in a material reduction in systemic risk, as well as a large increase in transparency. In addition to that, the global markets are more complicated for all of its participants. So here on the slide, we've decided to show you the pre to post trade workflow of an interest rate vanilla swap trade between Goldman Sachs and the Hong Kong-based client. So the point is, I'm not going to take you through every single box, everything that's written on it. But at least from looking at the slide, you should get a sense for the compliance complexity and the reporting requirements, as well as all of the parties from trading venues to clearing houses to multiple legal entities that are involved and necessary to achieve such a successful transaction of this kind. To put a few numbers to it, there's about 13 regulatory regimes that are affecting this particular vanilla swap trade. We execute about 500 of those on a daily basis. So that's 6,500 regulatory checks per day. And here I'm not even counting the more complex trades that we do, even in that just that asset class. Now, in order to tackle this complexity on behalf of our clients, and to provide them with a simple and seamless experience, first, we need to be very efficient. But more importantly, we need to build scale. Now, we're one of very few institutions who have the ability to navigate this market structure. And we do so through technological innovation, as well as technological implementation. So that leads us naturally to our second catalyst, the technological developments. We've essentially seen two parallel developments over the last decade plus. First of all, an exponential increase in the availability of data, especially that of market data, and a very, very large improvement in trading speed and execution performance. So I'll start with data first. It's become critical for market makers such as ourselves to be able to harness large amounts of data in real time. That means we had to build a robust and scalable data infrastructure, and ours is centered around a logical data model that's called Pure. We've recently open sourced that data model through our Alloy platform. Now, as far as execution performance and trading speed, Liz and Amy will take you specific examples in the businesses that they cover. I'll just mention one that I'm reasonably familiar with, which has to do with the high-touch client flow. You know, I mentioned that we moved on from floppy disks to the cloud. Well, the execution workflow for our high-touch clients is also dramatically changed. We used to require a client to call up or send an email to a salesperson with a request for a quote. That said, salesperson would actually load up their spreadsheet, pricing system, put in all the fields, communicate somehow with their trader by emails, shouting. You know, trader would look at the market environment, call their pricing functions, come up with a price, get back to the salesperson, reconcile what they had, and then get back to the client. That would take a few minutes, sometimes even more, depending on the complexity of the transaction. That workflow is completely changed. Now a client can IM or send an instant messaging message to Goldman Sachs and type something like REC 5Y swap, meaning they want to receive fixed on the 5-year swap. That is automatically passed through our natural language processing engine that's absorbed into our pricing system. It can hit the trader's desktop if a human is necessary to actually price the trade, or it can literally hit our systematic market making engine and the prices return instantaneously. We process more than 1,500 RFQs like this per day. Now, of course, this evolution in technology has led to a reasonably large increase in operational risk. We're constantly focusing on mitigating that risk. We're doing so by implementing policies and, more importantly, controls around it. So now on to our third and final catalyst, the changing mix of market participants. As you probably know, there's been a tremendous growth in passive assets across all markets, approximately 17% both in equity and fixed income since 2013 in annual growth. That's leading us to $10.7 trillion in passive funds globally approximately today. That's a little bit more than 35% of total assets. Now, if you take into account this trend and the continued consolidation, which is due to both the regulatory complexity and the technological developments we just mentioned, it looks like the markets are growing increasingly homogeneous, and in doing so, create the potential for procyclical ramifications. Now also, this growth in passive funds is leading to less frequent trading activity. What that means for market makers is that they actually have to extend beyond just providing liquidity and market access to clients. They have to try and solve clients' problems with respect to them becoming more cost efficient. To do that, we have to provide additional services. And we do so through our risk as a service, data as a service offering through our marquee platform, both digitally and through APIs. We're also exploring other services that can help our clients outsource some of their most costly functions to us. So we expect the markets to continue to evolve and to grow more complicated and for margins to end up compressing further. But that should mean a higher barrier of entry than we have today, and therefore should continue to reward the wholesale participants with the skill to thrive and capture a larger piece of the available wallet. And that therefore is positioning us extremely well to continue to be a market-leading liquidity and market access provider. Now, historically, we've excelled in risk intermediation of large and complex transactions, and thankfully, we still do. But over the last few years, we've made a lot of investments, especially in engineering, to adapt to the market structure evolution. And in doing so, we've been focusing on handling increased complexity on behalf of our clients and providing them a simple and seamless experience from pre to post trade and across the entire spectrum of global markets. That means including the more liquid flow businesses, as well as growing our financing footprint. And with this, I will turn it to Liz and Amy, who will take you through a deep dive in their respective businesses.
Sure, thanks, Ezra. So I'm going to talk a little bit about equities. So we've talked a bit earlier today about the investment we're making in our equities trading platform. And the way that we've really approached it is we've tried to put the needs of our clients in the center of all our investment decisions. And so we think about what they need today, what they're going to need in the future, and then we've been using that as a compass to really decide how we should invest and sequence the build of the trading platform. Now, the goal here is to be unlocking value for them throughout our actual deliveries as opposed to at the very end of the journey. So in addition to trends like automation, regulation, and consolidation that Ezra mentioned, there's a few trends in equities that are also really helping guide our investment strategy. So the first one is our clients have very advanced abilities to measure execution quality these days. And by that, I mean the all-in cost of their trading. And it's driven by two things. So the first thing is, particularly in equities and stock trading, you have an enormous amount of data. Stocks tick around the world every single day, every minute of the day. When I look at our US equities trading platform, it very routinely processes 5 to 6 million market data updates a second. And so if you pair all that data with really advanced ways to perform data analysis, our clients now have very, very precise ways to measure which broker is actually delivering them the lowest all-in cost of execution. And by that, they're moving beyond commissions and beyond the spread and actually starting to even think about the post-trade impact of which broker they're transacting with. And it's directly driving who they trade with. Now, the other thing is our clients really are trying to deploy their alpha more globally. And when they do that, they often trade in swap format as opposed to cash format. It's particularly important in the systematic client community. And so while the wallet in equities is definitely shifting more electronic, the systematic wallet, or certain wallets in equities, have more than doubled. So in Jim and Ashok's presentation on global markets, you know, they mentioned that the systematic wallet has doubled to $3.6 billion since 2012. And more than half of that wallet is actually outside the US, which are traditionally swap or synthetic traded markets. And so the punchline here is, as we're building, we need to deliver superior execution quality across a wide range of global markets. We need to be able to do it in swap format, cash format, and we need to do it with a very, very seamless experience for them. And so now the good news is, as we're investing here, is that in traditional voice trading, often our clients will deal with many, many partners, you know, 20 different people that they might call if they're looking for a different risk price. But when they're hooking up to you in an execution capacity or electronic capacity, they're going to deal with a handful of partners. And so our job is to be the essential partner for them. And so in response, we've been replatforming all the way through the trade lifecycle, from order entry to execution, booking, settlement, post-trade analysis. We've been uncompromising when it comes to the engineering standards. We're using the same technologies that on-exchange market makers would use. Our goal here is to level the playing field for our clients and other market participants. In many cases, we've brought in leading experts in the space. They've joined our teams. They've grown our teams. We're tackling 50 markets globally, a little bit more than 50 globally, the ones that are in highest demand for our quant and passive clients. Our clients need speed, they need resiliency, and they need scale, for sure. But they also need a lot of customization. They need our platform to be flexible for the changing ways that they trade or the unique ways that their institution trades. They also care a lot about the front-to-back experience. And so we've actually taken the same technologies and the same experts, and we've extended the platform, not just across prime and trading and execution, but actually into our operations platform, and really reimagined the level of service that we can deliver our clients from a post-trade perspective as well. So we've been at it for a few years, and we're really confident that using our clients as a compass has delivered results. A few things that we look at: our global stock trading platform, the strategic one, is processing 5 billion transactions a day at 300,000 times faster than the blink of an eye. And so for some perspective, that's about 60 times what Amazon processes on Prime Day, which is kind of fun to say now that Marco's here. Our strategic ops platform is demonstrating 99.9% straight-through processing rates on big, and actually even on days of high stress, it exceeds 99%. That exceeds our goal. When we started, we had set a 99.5% target for us. And 10 years ago, on today's volumes, we would have expected that to be about 60% straight-through processing. And Richard mentioned in the international presentation that we started early in Europe, and over the past few years, our market shares have more than doubled in the execution space. But what's even more exciting there is actually across equities, our ranks with clients have never been higher. And so it is a multi-year build, but today the foundations of this trading platform are in all three regions. We're going to be growing volumes across emerging and developed markets throughout the year. Amy, I'll hand it over to you.
Great. Thanks, Liz. In contrast to equities, the fixed income markets are at varying stages of evolution. You have markets like futures as well as spot FX, which are highly electronic, higher in speed, lower in latency. And at the opposite end of the spectrum, you also have OTC cash fixed income, like corporate bonds. As we drive forward, we're investing in tech, talent, as well as our risk management capabilities to best service our clients' needs. Let's take a deep dive into credit, where we've been pioneering a new market structure where we offer our clients pre-trade transparency, ease of execution, access to liquidity, as well as workflow efficiencies. Starting with the left-hand side of the slide that's up currently, we have something that we call our bond pricing engine, or our BPE, which generates live ticking MIDs across 32,000 corporate bonds globally. Now, this is different from the still dominant market paradigm where pricing of bonds is manual and levels are only as good as the last time a trader marked his or her book. The universe that is covered by the bond pricing engine, as well as the reliability of its MIDs, continue to expand as well as improve every single day. We've made some significant strides. We had only 4,000 reliable bond pricing engine MIDs in 2015. And by the way, those MIDs were very frequently overridden by our traders throughout the course of a trading day. Today, we're at 32,000 MIDs, and the bond pricing engine generates over 6 million updates per trading day. The BPE underpins our risk management as well as pricing functions for not only small lots, but also block risk transfer. It even ticks mids for dollar investment grade corporate bonds overnight for our Asian client base. Now, for a subset of bonds that are priced by the bond pricing engine, we provide liquidity to our clients entirely systematically. GS Algo, or GSA as we call it, makes markets in over 15,000 corporate bonds globally. It systematically looks at current as well as anticipated liquidity, whether or not we have an existing position, and estimates capital charges, among other things, to generate a bid and an offer that wraps around the bond pricing engine mid. And all of this is done without human touch. The algo handles client inquiries up to 2.5 million in size globally. It prices over 10,000 client inquiries per day and accounts for over 80% of our executed trades by ticket. Just to draw some parallels here, the US investment grade corporate bond trading desk executed fewer than 400 trades per day before the algo. Today, it executes over 2,000 trades per day. And these numbers will continue to grow as we scale. And with the algo, we are number one in US investment grade corporate bond electronic trading. The combination of our bond pricing engine, algo, and trading talent underpin our successes in more recent developments. Our ability to price bonds systematically, joined with our large and diverse bond inventory, fuels our bond ETF market making franchise, which has been market leading since 2016. And the portfolio optimization that we built for our ETF business catalyzed the innovations that we brought to portfolio trades. Now, it's probably worth detailing portfolio trading here. Portfolio trading, not new, but our approach has pushed the envelope. We are able to price large and complex portfolios of bonds in minutes as opposed to what used to be hours. And beyond simply pricing portfolios, we are also offering clients access to our proprietary portfolio optimization tools to improve their execution quality and their returns. Earlier in the global markets presentation, you saw that we've executed over $120 billion in portfolio trades since we modernized how clients trade bonds. We remain market leading in volumes. This was a clear-cut instance where we led industry change, garnered client adoption, and we have come out on top in the new market paradigm. Now, tying our systematic developments back to our digital strategy, we are making the bond pricing engine, as well as Goldman liquidity for bonds, available to our clients through Marquee via API on screens. Our successes today are the result of many years of R&D and investments, paired with our risk management aptitude, which is at the heart of our DNA. We are operating at scale, and we're looking to enhance our competitive position even further. Having looked under the hood, you can see it's quite complicated. But for our clients, we like to simplify their experience when they're dealing with Goldman. Electronic, voice, we're channel agnostic, and we're exclusively focused on client ease of access. For example, our Marquee APIs can connect directly into our clients' native environments, like their order or execution management systems, or into multilateral venues or bespoke ports. Client service is at the heart of our decision-making process. And beyond simple risk intermediation, we are creating solutions for and with our clients. Now, in our allotted time, we've only been able to review the nuts and bolts of our credit business, where the pace of change has been the fastest. But we have parallel efforts across all flow markets, where we are able to leverage technology to offer our clients better services. In rates, for example, we are focused on expanding the breadth as well as depth of liquidity that we are offering to our clients available at the touch. And in FX, as well as commodities markets, we've heard our clients loud and clear that the markets are fragmented and can be challenging to navigate. And so we are delivering to them a solution within the Marquee umbrella called Eirin, through which we are streamlining access to Goldman liquidity, our algos, as well as broader market access through a digital experience.
Amy, thank you very much for that. So before we move on to the Q&A part of the session, I'll start with a question for the two of you. So, you know, from everything we've discussed, the perception out there is that this market structure evolution is driving transparency and compressing margins further. We talked about it earlier. So can you take some time to walk us through the future economics of the opportunities that you see in front of us, respectively, in your businesses, why they should be attractive to our shareholders, and how, in respectively in your cases, you think we will continue to be a leading market liquidity provider?
Sure. I can start. So look, I mean, the perceptions are the realities in many cases. However, the way in which we're making money is also changing. And an equity is a $40 billion wallet. It's still a very sizable wallet when there's areas where we have room to grow. And so what's important is that our strategy is successful while acknowledging the realities in which we operate. And so what that looks like is having a best-in-class platform and then really leaning on our unique value propositions to our clients. And there are many, but I will talk about a few. So the first one is our clients' requirements are global, and they're very often on swap format. And so the bundle of execution and financing is incredibly important, and we're in a really good position to deliver that based also on the strength of our prime financing franchise. And so while there are wallets within equities that are contracting, there's also some that are growing. Swap commissions are actually up across the industry 13% over the past 4 years. And when a client executes on swap with you, they typically will often finance with you as well. And the financing revenues there can be 3 times or more what the actual swap commissions are. So another important one in terms of value propositions is securities lending. So our clients need access to securities lending globally, particularly to short stocks and market neutral books. And so based on our global footprint and also our diversified client base, we are very uniquely suited to particularly offer harder inventory to them. And that matters in places like the Middle East, that matters in places like China, which are markets that our clients are moving into. For example, last year in Saudi, we were the leading broker and traded north of 30% of the MSCI inclusion events. And then the third one, you know, we discussed that our clients really care about cost efficiency and dealing with the broker that's delivering the lowest all-in cost of trading. And so one of the most valuable things that we can do in order to insulate them from market impact is actually utilize our own balance sheet. Ashok talked in the global markets presentation about the fact that in equities we had delivered over $2 trillion of liquidity to our clients through our risk intermediation businesses. I'm assuming most people would think that that was definitely from our expertise in block and bespoke transactions, but actually $250 billion of that liquidity came through clients that were trading in our single stock algos, you know, 200 shares at a time. And when they did that and they used those algos, we generated $175 million of price improvement for them. And so it's a huge driver of value back to our clients and creates a virtuous cycle of increased market share. And as our franchise grows, we're recycling the benefits of that scale back to our clients while also increasing our own operating leverage, which is a really powerful ecosystem. You know, another good example is trading on exchange. You know, it costs twice as much to trade on exchange for a subscale provider as it does for a wholesale provider like us. And so it's hard to think that niche players will really be able to deliver that ecosystem to our clients, which is very beneficial for our share. Amy?
Yeah, I would say the FIC story is quite similar. Simply speaking, clients seek access to global markets. They want ease of execution across not only cash, but also derivatives. And they want access to financing. And so as the FIC markets continue to evolve, we will continue to invest to be the leading one-stop shop of choice for our clients across all of their needs. Just to share a few examples where our scale and our differentiated approach will help us continue to retain edge. I really like how you said it, Liz. Recycle benefits of our scale back to our clients. And we have so many instances where things that we're doing in one part of the business actually give us leverage to do new and different things for clients in another part of the business. One very specific example that comes to mind is you've heard about FIC financing as one of our core priorities for global markets. You've also heard a lot about Marquee, which has been shared for the most part as our client-facing digital storefront. What's really interesting here is as we build out our own FIC infrastructure for financing purposes, we're actually leveraging Marquee as the backbone that underpins our internal repo build-out. And so that's an example where we are recycling one set of capabilities in order to further enhance another set of capabilities. You've also heard a lot about our front-to-back alignment, where we are aligning our engineers, sales, and trading much more closely together in order to engage in agile R&D. Through tight coordination between engineering, sales, and trading, we've developed a market-leading trade and risk system for the full suite of FIC macro derivatives, complete with natural language processing, as well as automated pricing. In the innovation presentation today, Stephanie and Marco cited that the pace of innovation in the markets requires a dynamic approach. We are practicing this, and as a result, we're learning and driving progress every single day. Lastly, I feel like we've talked a lot about our own proprietary developments, but again, pointing back to the innovation presentation, Stephanie said that we have an emphasis on contemplating all of buy, build, partner, and invest as we look at growth opportunities. I'd like to take a second to also mention just how important we think partnership is for global markets. We are partnering with market structure influencers across the board to drive change and create value beyond what we can do by ourselves. And so we recently launched the Global Markets Strategic Partnerships Program, through which we are looking to drive holistic engagement with market structure influencers. And our goal here is to grow with our partners. By investing to simplify market access for our clients with a differentiated approach, we will continue to capture share.
Great, thank you. So I think we should move on to Q&A. So let's see what we see on the screen.
And just as a quick reminder, please do submit questions.
So what are we seeing here?
Yeah, why don't we take the one on talent? It looks like there's actually a couple. So it's competition for talent, impact to headcount. Ezra,
yeah, I'll start. I mean, I'll focus on the engineering technology part of the talent pool. I mean, clearly there's been a big shift in the skill set that's needed. You know, when I got hired, you know, I have a PhD in stochastic calculus, and that's what people were looking for. And the competition was only with like the traditional competitors, the other banks to price complex derivatives, essentially. That's completely changed now. We're looking for very strong programmers and great data scientists. Turns out that that's also what the big technology companies are looking for. So, you know, maybe I tell you, we think we're being successful at still attracting the best talent in that field, despite this larger competition. The idea is we allow those people to get access to the global markets, to interact with salespeople, with traders, with operations professionals, with bankers. They basically get exposed to a completely different new world that the technology companies don't necessarily allow them to be exposed to. And so far we've been reasonably successful in continuing to attract the best talent with the completely new set of skill sets that were needed. I don't know if Liz and Amy, you want to add anything to that question with respect to what you see in your businesses.
I mean, one of the things I'd add is that the way in which we cover our clients is changing.
Yeah.
Marco mentioned in his presentation that the developers are often the clients.
Yeah.
And we completely see that in a business like ours. And so often now when we're going and we're talking to a client, we're walking into a room and it's our engineer talking to their engineer, our quant talking to their quant and explaining a model. And so it does two things that are kind of cool. I mean, one is it really allows us to bring the best of Goldman Sachs and showcases to our clients. And so we talk a lot about platforms and building platforms and platforms, but the reality is the people build the platforms. And you know, we do have really good people doing that, and being able to put them on display to our clients has really given us an extension of our sales force. But I also think it makes the job cooler.
Yeah.
You know, like, it actually just makes, you know, when I think about the job for many of our engineers, a handful of years ago versus now, being able to drive the business and be part of those outcomes and really be an extension of our distribution force, I actually think leads to retention of talent.
I also think, I think the questions were geared towards engineering talent, but, I think we'd be remiss not to discuss sales and trading as well as operations talent. As we've automated many of the time-intensive, lower-value aspects of our day-to-day, I think that the sales, trading, as well as operations seats are much more exciting today than ever before. And, you know, frankly, our people are able to drive much more in the way of client value and differentiated services as a result.
Yeah, that's a good point. So let's see.
I know we're actually running out of time.
Yeah, so we probably have time for a couple more.
Yeah.
So what do we see there? There's one on how scale and efficiency efforts from automation impacting expense savings. So I'll give that one a go. You've seen some talk about the expense savings from global markets. And you've heard about front to back. I mean, it's been talked about. Amy just mentioned it. About a year and a half ago, we started this process of bringing the engineering professionals and operations professionals that were dedicated to global markets inside the division. So essentially make them part of the overall global markets business. The idea initially was to really understand the services that we're offering to our clients front to back, so from pre to post trade across the entire life cycle. When we started this effort with my co-heads about a year and a half ago, we started looking at, how much did they cost us, all these different services? But we didn't stop there. So sure, we started coming up with an idea of how much savings we could generate over a three-year period, and I can tell you it's about a third of the number that you've seen for global markets overall. But we also looked at the feedback we're getting from clients with respect to how satisfied they were with the different services. And so I think it's very important when we talk about expense savings here to highlight the point that it's not just about saving and being more efficient. As we're becoming more efficient, we'll provide better client service. So the idea is to do both at the same time. And so, we think that we're on the right track while we're focusing on becoming more cost efficient to actually deliver a much better quality of service to our clients, which, I think, Liz, in your business, you've seen the results of that.
Yeah, I mean, our clients actually measure the value that we are creating by automating our services across the whole trade life cycle. So, often your clients measure your performance in things like execution, but also increasingly in things like post-trade. I mean, we have things called broker scorecards, and a handful of years ago, it'd look at things like corporate access or, access to research analysts. But now, increasingly, for a lot of our bigger clients, they actually include a lot of operational metrics. They'll look at things like timeliness of confirms or straight through process rates or number of incidents in your operations stack. And so as we improve that, our rankings and our performance with our clients improve, and actually then we become, a bigger broker of choice for them. Yeah. So they're completely measuring it.
Yeah, absolutely. So, okay, one last one. There's one for you, Amy, right there. How will you monetize investments like Marquee and other services or APIs?
That's a good one. So just taking a quick step back, we have a few things that I think are really important to point out in the context of Marquee. First and foremost, we are not encumbered by a monolithic legacy digital client offering. And so we're able to build something that is suited to our clients' needs today. We also have very strong businesses across global markets, which give us a clear line of sight into what our clients' needs are so that we can be client-centric in our approach as we continue to develop our Marquee platform. And lastly, I would say that, we have the most robust and critical group of quality assurance testers within the four walls here at Goldman on our trading desk, which ensures that we are delivering quality products to our clients. On the question of monetization, I think there are really two ways that we look at it. There is implicit as well as explicit value when it comes to what we're doing with Marquee. The implicit side of the equation is quite obvious. We've got strong global businesses, and Marquee will enable us to further fortify the services that we offer to our clients. And so I think that is pretty obvious to everybody. On the explicit side of the equation, as we deliver solutions, analytics, capabilities to our clients, as well as our partners that are of value, I think that, that part of the equation will solve itself.
May I make a plug?
If you have not already done so, please do visit the Marquee kiosk for a demo. It's just right outside of the auditorium, and the team is there and very excited to see you all.
Okay, well, I think that concludes our breakout session. Thank you again for being here. And if you have any additional questions, we're happy to see you at the reception a little bit later.